Alhamdulillah, الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. وصلى الله على سيدنا حبيبنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. وبعد. We begin by praising Allah Azza wa Jal as He is most worthy and deserving of all praise. We ask Allah and we ask Allah alone to guide us, to prevent us from being misguided and from misguiding others. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us of our shortcomings, our sins, those that we commit knowingly and those that we commit unknowingly. And finally, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless the noble Prophet Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, to bless his noble companions, his family, and the righteous everywhere. Ameen. Respected brothers and sisters, we find ourselves by Allah's fadl at the cusp, at the very beginning or near the very beginning of the month of Ramadan. We are in the final days of Sha'ban, and before you know it, as I imagine many of us feel, we are already, and we will already find ourselves in the midst of Ramadan. And so I want to talk to you and speak with you today briefly about Ramadan and the opportunities that the month presents for us and to us. And it is indeed by Allah's fadl that we still find ourselves in good health, in good being, in good status, and certainly alive to experience this beloved month of Ramadan. Because this is a unique opportunity not only in this particular year, but also for a lifetime, to be able to enjoy and to be able to achieve the blessings that the month of Ramadan affords us. And I say that deliberately because I think oftentimes we think of Ramadan or we fall into a tendency of just saying, well, we find another Ramadan upon us. And that's not the ideal mindset, certainly, to approach the month of Ramadan with. Because the month of Ramadan, and by that I mean every single Ramadan, presents unique opportunities and presents unique challenges. But those unique opportunities are for blessings that are attained and can be attained only in this particular month. And by that I mean Ramadan of 2018, Ramadan of the Hijri year, this particular Ramadan. Because the blessings that you have in store for us, or that we have in store for us individually and collectively, are those blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed for us to achieve and to be blessed with in this month of Ramadan. But as we approach the month of Ramadan, I think it's important for us to remember a few things, or a few sort of introductory or mindset, the way we can refocus our mindset with regards to how it is that we approach the month of Ramadan. And so first and foremost, as a reminder to myself and to all of us, that Ramadan is a catalyst. And as a catalyst goes, it is there to expedite things. It is there to make things more powerful, more significant. It serves a function. And so when I say Ramadan is a catalyst, I mean that it is an opportunity for us to recalibrate our focus with regards to how we and what our relationship is, first and foremost with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but also what is our relationship with the Book of Allah, with the Quran. And as we'll talk about momentarily, this is a month that celebrates one of the features that makes the month of Ramadan so significant is that it is a month of the Qur'an. It is a month of the Qur'an even more so than it is a month of fasting. And I'll explain what I mean shortly. But the fact is that the month of Ramadan affords us an opportunity to increase in our relationship. In our relationship with Allah, His Book, His Prophet, all of the ibadat that we are able to achieve and able to do in the month of Ramadan. So Ramadan is that catalyst that's there to allow us to recalibrate our focus, to be resolved in what we want to achieve in the month of Ramadan. Ramadan, beyond being a catalyst, is a boot camp. And by that I mean it is a day of, it is a month of 29 to 30 days where we must give it our all. And much like any other boot camp, we are going to have challenges in that month. These days are going to be long. These days may be very hot. And so certainly that poses a challenge for us physically. We may have challenges that are unique to us individually. That is to say, something that is unique challenges that we face. Perhaps we've been not as diligent in our ibadat with Allah, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Perhaps we've seen some of our prayers not have that khushu'a, that tranquility. Or perhaps we've not been as regular with our prayers as we would like. Or perhaps we haven't been able to strengthen our resolve with regards to how we, our relationship with the Book of Allah. Perhaps we've been negligent in recitation of the Quran on a frequent or daily or any kind of, with any great deal of frequency. And so what this month of Ramadan allows us is that it allows us an opportunity in these 29 to 30 days to really give it our all and to engage in the ibadat, to engage in the recitation of the Quran, so that we can strengthen our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But much like any boot camp, brothers and sisters, is that what really the challenge, or what the opportunity of a boot camp, if you will, presents, is that the lessons that we learn, the activities that we do in these 29 or 30 days, that these are activities and opportunities that we should avail ourselves for the rest of the year, for the remainder of the year. It's not just something that we do in the month of Ramadan. So if you are increasing in your salawat, in your prayers, if you're increasing in your recitation of the Quran, it's not just meant for the sake of the month of Ramadan alone, but rather Ramadan affords us an opportunity to engage in these practices so that we can continue those practices for the remainder of the year. It allows us an opportunity to increase in these things, not so that they fall to the wayside as soon as Shawwal hits, but rather they continue for the remainder of the year. So yes, Ramadan is a catalyst. Yes, Ramadan is that boot camp. But if this is the sprint, if Ramadan is seen as the sprint, right? If any of you run on any occasion, you know that a sprint is where you run at your fastest, with full speed, you give it your all, and it's usually for a shorter distance of time. But Islam is not a sprint. Our relationship with Allah, or our relationship with His book, or our relationship with His deen, is not a sprint. It's a marathon. It is a marathon. We're in it for the long haul. We're in it for the long period. And so if Ramadan is the sprint, then what we are preparing ourselves for is the marathon. This is the month that we can prepare ourselves for the longevity of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what Ramadan is. If Ramadan is the sprint, and it is, remember that Islam and our relationship with this deen is a marathon. It's for the long run. It's for the long term. And so that is how we should collectively and individually calibrate our mindset as we begin to approach the month of Ramadan. And so now, beyond the mindset alone, we can begin to look at some of those things, some of those qualities that are unique and essential to this month of Ramadan. As we all know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the very purpose, the very purpose of the month of Ramadan is la'allakum tattaqun. Right? In the oft-repeated verse that we hear probably more often than ever in the month of Ramadan or in the days preceding Ramadan, is the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordains fasting upon us. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu kutiba alaykumus siyam
كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون.
So, O you who believe, O people of faith, fasting has been ordained for you, has been prescribed to you, as it was ordained and prescribed to people before you, to communities and nations that came before you.
لعلكم,
there is a illa here, there is a purpose.
لعلكم تتقون,
so that you may develop God consciousness. And the word taqwa, brothers and sisters, comes from wiqaya in the Arabic language. And wiqaya means to prevent oneself, or to prevent oneself from certain things, or to protect oneself. So it is an act of prevention and an act of protection. And what we are preventing ourselves from, as we know in the month of Ramadan, is even those things that are lawful to us.
لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ,
so that we may achieve God consciousness. We are preventing ourselves from even those things that are lawful. We're allowed to drink water. We're allowed to drink juices and enjoy the bounties of the food and beverages that Allah has given us. We're allowed those things. But in the month of Ramadan, we give up even the lawful, even those things that are lawful. Why?
لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ,
so that we may achieve God consciousness. But wiqaya also signifies a kind of protection. Because as the Prophet ﷺ, he reminded us that fasting, asiyam, that fasting is a shield. It protects us. It protects us. And the way in which fasting protects us and preserves us is that when we engage in giving up even the lawful, even those things that are lawful, then what can we say of those things that are unlawful? So by challenging ourselves to even give up those things that we are allowed to enjoy, those things that are permitted to us, day in and day out, it is a reminder that we should be protecting ourselves, preventing ourselves from engaging in the unlawful, in those things that are unlawful to us, either in the month of Ramadan or outside of the month of Ramadan. So we give up even the bounties of Allah so that we can strengthen ourselves, so that we can strengthen our spirits, our resolve, so that we can protect ourselves and shield ourselves from those things that are forbidden to us. And that is what the month of Ramadan affords us an opportunity. So لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, the God consciousness that we are to achieve, an obedience to God that results from that God consciousness, is the purpose of the month of Ramadan. And so when we fast day in and day out, when we turn up to the masjid to offer the Taraweeh prayer, the night vigil prayers, when we engage in the extra adhkar and the extra recital of the Quran, when we engage in i'tikaf, in spiritual retreat, in the last and final days of the month of Ramadan, all of that has a purpose, and that purpose is to achieve God consciousness. Because God consciousness, once achieved, it will lead to obedience. It will lead to obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the purpose of the month of Ramadan. But to move beyond just taqwa as a lesson, as I said, that the month of Ramadan, even more than being a month of fasting, is a month that celebrates the Quran. And what do I mean by that? This verse that I just recited, that is often recited in conjunction with Ramadan, O you who believe, fasting is prescribed to you. This verse was actually not revealed in the context of the month of Ramadan. That is to say that this was revealed before the prophetic community was prescribed to fast in the month of Ramadan. It was simply a reminder to the believers that fasting was prescribed to them like it was prescribed to earlier communities, the earlier nations, Jews and Christians and other faith communities that came before the Muslim community, the prophetic community, that they also fasted. And so it was a reminder
of the fact that that these earlier communities practiced this form of ibadah, this form of worship, fasting. But the context of this verse was not Ramadan. It was not a prescription, or Allah was not ordaining the fast of Ramadan, but rather simply the ibadah of Ramadan, of fasting. The ibadah of siyam was what was revealed or ordained in this verse. And so this verse speaks not specifically to Ramadan. But interestingly enough, the verses that follow that verse, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually names explicitly Shahru Ramadan, he talks about it in the context of what? Shahru Ramadan alladhi unzila fihi al-Qur'an hudan lin-nas wa bayyinatin min al-huda wal-furqan. That the month of Ramadan is the month in which the Qur'an was revealed as a source of guidance for all of humanity and as a criterion to distinguish between right and wrong, as a furqan, as a criterion by which we judge. And so the month of Ramadan is inextricably connected with revelation, with wahi, with the Qur'an, with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know, according to the prophetic biography, that revelation began for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by the vast majority of opinions, in the month of Ramadan. That it was the habit of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to engage in a kind of spiritual retreat in this month, where he would go to the caves and he would he would engage in a kind of dhikr and a kind of self-reflection. Yatahannath is what the hadith tells us, that the Prophet would engage in this kind of exercise of adhkar and remembering his Lord and self-reflection and devotion. And so it was during this time that the angel Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam reveals or begins the process, the revelatory process, the process of revelation. And so the month of Ramadan, what makes it unique and apart from the other months, yes, we fast in it, but the true connection to the month of Ramadan is with the revelation of the Quran. And so this is Shahru Quran. This is the month of the Quran. And so this is why the scholars tell us, the ulama, they tell us, and our elders, and our spiritual elders inform us, that the best form of ibadah in the month of Ramadan is recital, is tilawatul Quran, is the recital of the Quran. Whether we know it, whether we understand its meaning or not, that simply engaging in tilawa is the best form of ibadah in the month of Ramadan. Now I say that, and some people say, well, brother, we're supposed to read the Quran and understand it, and we're supposed to reflect on it, and we're supposed to implement it. All of that is true. But in the month of Ramadan, uniquely, it is the tilawa of the Quran. Just recital as much as possible. That is the best form of worship. And this is why in Muslim tradition, throughout our history, our intellectual history, the various schools and madrasas and where educational endeavors would take place, in the month of Ramadan, they would close the books of tafasir, they would close the books of commentary, they would close the books of law and jurisprudence and theology and grammar and rhetoric, and everything else would be put aside except the book of Allah. And the students would engage only in tilawa, because that is the most beloved devotional act that we can do in the month of Ramadan. And so it is our challenge then, whether we have been recalcitrant, we've been negligent in how we've been reciting the Quran, or how often, whether it's gathering dust on our bookshelves, regardless of where we are with our relationship to the Book of Allah, this is the month. This is that catalyst. This is that catalyst. This is that boot camp that we can recalibrate and reconnect with the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Finally, brothers and sisters, the month of Ramadan is a reminder of the fact that we belong to a community. that we belong to a community. We are not individuals that, but rather we find happiness and joy and meaning and comfort and fraternity and sorority in our communities. And the month of Ramadan is a month in which, by the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have an opportunity to reconnect with our community. If we've been, again, absent, if we haven't been able to dedicate as much time as we would like in the masjid, in the houses of Allah, with our fellow brothers and sisters, then Ramadan allows us an opportunity to celebrate and to reconnect with our community. And this is why so many things that occur in the month of Ramadan are communal and not individual. They are collective. We come every night and we gather and we recite and we stand in prayer in the Tarawih prayers. This is a form of communal worship. This is a form of communal ibadah. We have opportunities to feed others who are fasting. We have opportunities to celebrate and break fast with our kith and kin, those that are close to us, even strangers. We break fast with those, with members of our community. And we celebrate this community. And we celebrate those things that make this community so beautiful, so unique, so special. And so this month of Ramadan is an opportunity for us to connect with and engage with our communities. And so we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala affords us all the ability to achieve all of the blessings that we can possibly achieve in the month of Ramadan. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us all success, gives us all the energy and the commitment that we need to fulfill the best that we can be in the month of Ramadan and to achieve the utmost in this blessed month. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَأَخْرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصلى الله على سيدنا حبيبنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قول يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها بثهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا. ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا. ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبا على دينك. يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبا على دينك. اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. وأقيموا الصلاة.